Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and we're back to the Acteurist Oeuvre-view for Dorothy McGuire, Part 8. We've reached the mid-1950s, and we'll be discussing Trial and Friendly Persuasion. We'll start out with the 1955 film Trial, and as always, we'll hear from our friend Leonard Maltin from his TV, Movies, and Video Guide 1991 edition. He gives the film 3 stars out of a possible 4. Intelligent filming of Don Mankiewicz's novel, scripted by the author. Court rumor involves Mexican boy accused of murder.
Court rumor.
But actually tied in with pro versus anti-communist politics. The director, Mark Robson. And the cast list, Glenn Ford, Dorothy McGuire, John Hodiak, Arthur Kennedy, Katie Girardeau, and Rafael Campos.
So I guess I would agree with Maltin on this occasion.
That it involves pro versus anti-communist politics.
Well, I don't know how much pro-communism there is in this movie. It involves more than one side to the communist issue, for sure. It's kind of court rumor that you call intelligent, involving some tricky politics, you know, reminiscent of other movies from around the same period, like Anatomy of a Murder.
Yeah, I was thinking of that and Advising Consent. So it does have a Preminger vibe, a proto-late-style Preminger vibe, but it's not Preminger, it's Mark Robson. And you have found an article.
Yeah, I found another article from handy old JSTOR.
So last week we had a lot of talk about Mission to Moscow and what it said about various factions on the American left and possibly the American right as well.
And how it fed into McCarthyism.
So before the Red Scare, the second Red Scare. Now we're kind of on the downward slope of that movement. It reached its high tide in 1954 with the Army McCarthy hearings, where Joseph McCarthy basically bit off more than he could chew and tried to fight the army and lost. Looked like a complete fool on national television. It's not like America became any less anti-communist after that point, but the brand of anti-communism did start to change. You start getting the ascendancy more of Cold War liberals. Think of people like the Kennedys, right? Hardcore anti-communists, but not defending a conservative domestic agenda. They were trying to keep these things straight, and it's really about geopolitics more than anything. Opposing the Soviet Union rather than focusing on people at home in America who are traitors.
Well, according to the article I found, the people who made this film, including head of production Dori Sherry, were such Cold War liberals.
Well, this is the most Cold War liberal-ish movie I've ever seen. Clearly got a problem with the Comintern, but also clearly has a problem with people like McCarthy.
So I should state, first of all, I must issue a correction for last week. Been so long since I've used JSTOR on a regular basis that I ended up reading the record wrong and giving the wrong name of the journal that I found this article in, A Great Historic Mistake, The Making of Mission to Moscow.
Oh.
I gave the issue name instead of the journal name. The journal name is Film History. The issue was Politics and Film.
Oh, they did a little special.
Yeah, so this is from Indiana University Press, this journal. Of course, this is the age of Google, so if anyone actually Googled the title and JSTOR, I'm sure they would have found it just fine, but we're trying to be loosely scholarly in an irresponsible way here, so I had to give my correction. So this week, my article is also from Film History.
It's a handy journal.
And the title of it is From Even-Handedness to Red-Baiting, The Transformation of the Novel Trial by Daniel J. Lieb. There are some odd things about the article, such as that it starts out by emphasizing that this movie made good money for MGM, that it was one of their most successful releases, and then ends up by saying that it was disappointing as a moneymaker. They're not contradictory things, but...
Yeah, well, I don't think MGM was doing so well in 1955, so maybe their biggest money moneymakers were disappointing.
He gets really into the minutiae of America's feelings about communism at this time. So Army versus McCarthy isn't mentioned, but he does think that kind of minute shifts we're talking about. Well, first of all, we've got the novel, which was optioned before it was published.
When was it written?
Well, in September 1954, Agent Harold Ober offered the novel in galleys to various companies in Hollywood. Army McCarthy hearings are April to June 1954. So they're looking at optioning the movie soon after that.
Makes sense.
But what this writer is saying, by the time we get to MGM marketing the movie, there was a shift to a milder Cold War period. Something to do with Eisenhower? Does this ring a bell, Dave?
Well, sure. Eisenhower hated McCarthy, who was in his own party, right? Eisenhower wasn't a Republican prior to running for president. He had no party affiliation. The Democrats wanted him to run for them in 1952. He was perceived as, you know, the ultimate moderate on both sides, and everyone knew if he decided to run for them, they'd win. And the Republicans seemed to be in a better position because the Democrats had been running the country for 20 years, and people were sick of them, the way these things swing back and forth. So he runs as a Republican, and they balance a ticket with a more right-wing vice president, Richard Nixon. Eisenhower's not really interested in amping up the Cold War. And let's not forget, I think it has more to do with the fact that Stalin was dead, right? He dies in 1953.
Well, what Lieb says here, he does not mention Stalin. Stalin is much on our brains after last week. What he says is, the de-emphasis of Trial's vigorous anti-communism in the studio's selling campaign may result from the fact that it premiered and played out its run from mid-1955 to mid-1956, at a time when such attitudes no longer seem so propitious. Internationally, the U.S., as a result of a July 1955 summit meeting in Geneva between the Soviet Union's leaders and President Eisenhower, as well as his British and French counterparts, had committed itself to a thaw in relations with the USSR. I guess that has to do with Stalin.
Well, it sure does.
Dying. He just doesn't mention it because he expects me to know that.
Khrushchev and the people that were aligned with Khrushchev, I mean, they initiated de-Stalinization. It didn't stop the Soviet Union from barging into the news in a kind of negative way in the mid-1950s, because it's during this period, 1956, when they crush Hungary. But the only reason that there was an uprising in Hungary is because they were starting to feel a little bit like they might be able to break away, right? Because Stalin was gone. They were wrong, unfortunately. So it was still a complicated time.
Domestically, although as historian Richard Fried maintains, the crusade against communism by no means collapsed, the Red Scare slowly eroded in the face of a more determined and acceptable opposition that led, among other actions, to the censure of Senator Joseph McCarthy and to various Supreme Court rulings, such as Pennsylvania versus Nelson, which hobbled anti-subversive activity and restored civil liberties. But I guess, so what's being said here is that the movie is made in between the period when the book was made, when McCarthyism was somewhat more of a threat, and this period afterwards, when there was a relaxing of anti-communist sentiment.
It's not like anyone was willing to accept that communism or even socialism was a viable political ideology. That didn't get into the mainstream discourse, right? But you do have civil liberties discourse coming in. Edward R. Murrow is probably the prime exemplar of that, right? The voice of reason on the evening news. The idea being communicated is that communism on the home front is not really the threat it was being portrayed as. Communism in the Soviet Union is, and we don't want to lose what makes America America by going on these witch hunts. However, no one is willing to entertain drastic socialist changes on the American home front, and if there had been a huge movement, I don't know what would have happened. But they were correct. There weren't enough people talking about this to even matter in the mainstream.
Now, the bulk of the article is devoted to arguing that the movie very much downplays the anti-McCarthyism of the novel.
Really?
According to Lieb, novel is, well, even-handed, as he says in the title, equally attacking McCarthyism and communism. And this got diluted by by MGM executives who were worried about this relaxing of the anti-communist sentiment in the movie by having not a McCarthy character, but a related witch hunter who is actually based on someone else, not McCarthy.
Right, but we never even really see him, right? It's all off stage, which is very interesting.
Well, I think this is part of the downplaying.
Exactly. They sideline it. Everyone basically says that committee is a bunch of bullshit. We all know it. We're not even going to dramatize it because it's so silly at this point. Alicia Cook Jr., not named by Leonard Maltin, is following Dorothy McGuire around and following Glenn Ford around. But even he says, you know, I don't think you have to worry about appearing before that committee. They're not going to fight with a real American like you.
Do you think that that is more devastating to McCarthyism to not take it seriously at all?
I think it is, yeah. But it also possibly was a way to hedge their bets by not making it center stage.
Right, and not making it seem like a real threat to the American way of life.
A few years later, you have the Manchurian Candidate, where we do have the buffoonish McCarthy caricature making speeches about having lists of names and, you know, that kind of circus. At that point, they're really looking back and having a good laugh about it. Here, I guess, maybe they thought that would be too much.
Although, when Dorothy McGuire gets her best scene because of this downplaying, where she gets to play the McCarthy-esque interrogator.
Oh, it's so good.
She doesn't portray him as a buffoon. She says he is going to get you, and this is how he's going to do it.
I think the movie is saying she's way smarter than this guy is. She may be overestimating the enemy.
Well, she's underestimating Glenn Ford. He hasn't come through yet at this point to show exactly what he's made of. So apparently, battle was supposed to be based on State Senator Jack Tenney, chairman of the California Legislators Little Un-American Activities Committee. Mm. This is supposed to be a disguised California that this is set in.
Yeah, they don't ever say what state it's in.
And also, looking at the article again, it was the production code that strenuously objected to the screenplay's portrayal of investigative committees.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, they get their criticism in anyway, but again, it has to be by indirection, I suppose.
Now, you were saying that part of the reason for relaxing anti-communism on the domestic front is because it just, nobody at this point thought that it actually posed a real threat. Now, the movie kind of has its cake and eats it too, in that it does seem to be stirring up Cold War paranoia and making it seem like these domestic communists are reasonably powerful and very weird. Well, and insidious. But then when you get down to the portrayal of the Dorothy McGuire character, apparently this was a trope, the communist woman who is saved by the love of a good man. But if so, this is a very specific and detailed version of that that doesn't quite play out that way.
No, because she's already lost her faith in the party long before she meets.
But also, she has retained some remnants of loyalty that prevent her from warning him, and yet that, even that isn't made to portray her as a villain.
No.
She's definitely not in any way, and that's the most interesting part, portrayed as a villain. She's portrayed, well, we'll talk about the character and how she's portrayed, but she's portrayed as a reasonable person.
Let's look at what the stakes are here. For their petty political movement, which is never going to go anywhere, they are willing to crucify this boy who we love. You know, the movie takes pains to give us time to get to know this kid. He's great. He's exactly what we want American boyhood to be. You know, he wants to grow up to be a lawyer just like Glenn Ford, and the communists, because they're trying to stir up dissent in America, are willing to have him be executed over that.
And race hatred. Hatred between the races.
And of course, this was something that people did talk about a lot in the 50s and prior and later, that external enemies of the United States would seize on its white supremacist insanity and say, hey, here's a problem with America. Let's sow dissent. It was certainly part of the Eisenhower playbook to do what they could to mitigate that. I mean, that is certainly one reason that the American government allowed the civil rights movement to build steam in the 50s and into the 60s, because they knew Soviet Union was watching and amplifying every racist fiasco that occurred in America, and there was one every single day. The movie's perspective is that America is this glorious progressive work in progress, and if we're just allowed to figure this out on our own without interfering communists who have no investment in the American project, we're going to get it right. And of course, I don't believe that. So the stakes, I mean, it really reduces it down to this level of, you know, the Communist Party doesn't think any one individual life is sacred. It's willing to sacrifice any pawn for this perceived gain.
Oh, sure. And you hear that rhetoric over and over and over and over again. anything. They'll just do anything for the cause.
The movie is downplaying this witch hunt aspect. It's saying these are crackpots who could do real harm in individual cases like this, but they don't have a chance of really influencing the political culture. We're all too confirmed in our Americanness at this point, and we're not worried anymore. We're not suffering this paranoia that McCarthy represented that we finally exercised.
So there was a case that Mankiewicz, who we didn't even mention.
Is he related to the film Mankiewicz's?
Son of Mank.
Okay.
Son of Citizen Kane Mank.
Herman.
Yeah. This was the case of Willie McGee, a black Mississippi truck driver in his 30s, I'm reading from the article, whose ordeal began in 1946 when he was convicted of raping a white housewife despite persuasive evidence to support his claim that she initiated a sexual relationship with him, at least as early as 1942. So I'm a little confused by this portion of the article because he says that the communists saved McGee twice from being sentenced to death, but then the third time, the communist support was what did sentence him to death because it was considered a kiss of death.
Well, that has nothing to do with the Communist Party arranging it.
No. There was nothing of that kind. That seems to be totally fictitious. Right. There is no mention in this article of any case being like that, other than, quoting from the article again, what C. Peer, so Communist Party member, Jessica Mitford, who worked earnestly to spare McGee, not inappropriately described as a ritual race murder, took place on 8th of May, 1951, near the height of the Red Scare, amidst a great hue and cry about communists using the McGee case for their own nefarious purposes of manipulating the case for their own ends, namely to sow social unrest and to embarrass America. This was anti-communists saying this, but there's no evidence that that was actually happening.
No, of course not. And I don't buy for one moment that the Communist Party would try to engineer the execution of our protagonist here, because they didn't need to, right? Saving someone would be good publicity. And if they need to talk about people being executed by the government, it happened every single day. They could just pick any newspaper headline and they could show racial injustice, racial injustice, racial injustice. They didn't have to make it happen the way this movie makes it seem. If someone does get executed, they will use it for propaganda purposes, which of course they would.
What this case is showing is that the communist kiss of death was not that they were deliberately sacrificing the accused. The kiss of death was that people thought they were doing that. It's all very confused here. What either Mankiewicz thought he was saying by using this case, or what the writer of the article thinks he's saying by talking about the case.
Now, what the movie is getting at, which is something that we talked about last week, right? What intellectuals did not like about the Communist Party, aligned with the Comintern, is that there were changes in direction constantly.
Well, when Dorothy McGuire talks, okay, I guess we're going to jump right into that. When Dorothy McGuire talks about her reasons for leaving the Communist Party,
it's exactly like what we said last week.
Yeah, it's exactly how we would have felt, how we could never have been members of the Communist Party, because we would have been like, well, this is just stupid. You can't think for yourself. Nothing they're doing or saying makes any sense. It doesn't seem like this is furthering any good agendas. You know, not because we don't agree with socialist agendas. We're too hopelessly bourgeois for this. We want to think and we want to criticize and we want to criticize you.
Everything that was communicated to the Communist Party of America was just about tactics, right? How to deal with the American political scene. What kinds of stunts are you going to pull? What kinds of rhetoric are you going to use? What are you going to advocate? Intellectuals like to think about that stuff for themselves and try to create a real discourse. And what she's saying, and I think that this is the lived experience of people who were Communist Party members, sometimes what the party was advocating did align with what they thought they should do in that context, and other times it didn't.
And it also constantly changed in ways that the contradictions were obvious, and then you had to pretend there were no contradictions, right?
Right. If you were a member of that party. Now, there were many other socialist parties and organizations where you didn't have to do that. But this particular party, sure, it was centralized. And hence, you get all these fellow travelers who are interested in the goal, but have their disagreements with the various stratagems devised.
And she's not even talking about Stalin.
She's talking about
just the Communist Party being annoying.
And Arthur Kennedy.
So Arthur Kennedy, who did get a Best Supporting Actor nomination for this role, is so absolutely fantastic until the end when his character is thrown under the bus and he just becomes a boring villain. But up until then, you know, he's like sinister throughout the whole thing.
Oh man, that and first scene where he's interrogating his prospective client.
And smacking them around.
Oh man,
and terrorizing the mother. Yeah, he's just he's fascinating. He's just fascinating to watch this character.
This is our year of Arthur Kennedy, and it's not by design, but we've had Some Came Running. We're going to have Peyton Place later this year. He got a lot of serious acting opportunities in the 1950s, and he did not miss on any of them, as far as I'm concerned.
I find Glenn Ford excellent in this movie.
Yes.
So perfectly a counterpoint to Arthur Kennedy. He is so quiet and internalized with this sort of edgy, noirish desperation.
It's the big heat as a nerd.
It's like watching De Niro and Pacino in a movie together. It's that kind of totally quiet, internalized, crackling with tension performance versus the all-out crazy hamminess of Arthur Kennedy.
Yeah, and Dorothy McGuire, I think this is a good role for her.
We were saying she'd entered her mother era, but here again she is, I mean, it's a very small role. She's definitely the love interest.
With a kind of dubious past, I mean, that gradually emerges, she's got a bit of her Pat Ruscom quality to her.
Yeah, a bit of the Till the End of Time character's quality. Yeah, just this very unapologetically adult character.
Yeah, which she's better at playing than just about anyone in this era or ever.
So again, a professional woman love interest. So the PCA obviously wasn't happy about this character. The article says she is considered too blunt in her language, too easygoing in her actions, and treacherous because she prefers no warning to David when he agrees to fly east for the New York City rally.
Well, she does tell Arthur Kennedy, I think he's too tired. He can't make it out there. That's really all the effort she can make.
But it doesn't seem like any of that was, I mean, maybe some things were changed in the script, but all of that, what they're saying there, definitely is still part of the character.
I agree. That's a bold choice and rough edges on her as a character, as many of these Dorothy McGuire characters do, and yet she is endorsed as a love interest all the way through, right up to the end, and they do wind up as a couple. You know, she doesn't have to be sacrificed, she doesn't have to be shunned.
Yeah, she's already changed her ways, but not in a really dramatic way.
No, I don't think she has. She still seems to have the same beliefs about what was wrong with America in the first place. It's just that she's soured on the Communist Party of America as a vehicle for changing them.
So yeah, as you say, the propaganda of this movie, which is also very much a propaganda movie, is the idea that liberalism can solve the problems that communism has identified.
Yeah, and of course we've seen that it can't. But I guess to give them the benefit of the doubt, they probably didn't know that for sure in 1955.
And it probably seemed like a good moment to try. The hope for that didn't last long.
The high tide of all of that, I guess, would be LBJ's Great Society and some of the initiatives undertaken during the mid-1960s, but going on at the exact same time as the Vietnam War.
Sure,
screwing up everything.
And the idea of there being an affluent society, a welfare state, everyone copying Europe's welfare state in the aftermath of the war, and that didn't work out either.
Nope.
Did not come to be. It was a nice dream. Nice dream for everybody who was like, oh, we don't really want what happened to the Soviet Union to happen here. Okay, well, so that first scene where Arthur Kennedy is roughing up Angel Chavez and his mother.
Katie Jurado, great actress as well. I know her best from High Noon, but she's quite prevalent in 1950s cinema.
The actor is Rafael Campos, who
he was really good.
Yeah, he had been in Blackboard Jungle.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like there is a bit of an aporia in the portrayal of this character. I never did understand how the buttons on this girl's dress got ripped, and no one was, it doesn't feel like anyone would have even had any good reason to question his story unless that had happened. He does say in that first brutal interview that we were making love, and that's when Arthur Kennedy smacks him and says, never say that again, and he never does.
Right.
So there is a question about to what degree he was doing what he was accused of. Now, the movie, it's an aporia because after that, the movie uniformly portrays him as a saint. A minor having sex with a minor with little to no age difference in Canada is not a crime, so this is not something that would morally excite me very much. But regardless, how do things get so violent that the girl's dress is ripped and she goes running off? I mean, the movie doesn't make any sense of this. It doesn't make any sense within the movie. It's an aporia.
Right, and that is why the DA is able to cast enough doubt on what happened to convince the jury that it was a felony in progress, whatever.
And what does he even mean at the end when he says, I believe he's technically guilty? So technically guilty of what? Okay, this is a weird crime also, by the way. This crime of if a death happens in the course of committing another felony, in this case statutory rape, it is first-degree murder. Like, that in itself is bizarre.
Yeah, but that's what John Hodiak says. He says, in my mind, something sexual is going on between them. That's a felony.
So he means technically guilty of murder.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, he thinks something was happening between them. Not anything that should have killed her, but it did because of her heart condition.
Right.
And so he's okay with this loophole that they find that sends him more to a juvenile hall, basically. Now, I agree with you. It doesn't seem like any real crime was committed unless...
Except for those, the button detail.
Yeah, unless they just got ripped because they were...
That's some heavy petting. I have no idea. Undecidable.
No, they don't show us the scene and we never...
Yeah, a flashback could have cleared this up.
Yeah, no, they don't want to do that. The judge was great. Juano Hernandez.
Right, right. Well, this was very much remarked upon, this portrayal of this judge.
He's an amazing actor. I know him from Intruder in the Dust, which is a tremendous movie from the late 40s. And he has an excellent role in that one, too.
It's unfortunate that they make him face off against the communist, as if this is some kind of necessary tension at the end of the movie. But he and Arthur Kennedy do play a really great scene together, where Arthur Kennedy is trying to bait him into giving him more publicity.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. And of course, it plays in with the film's thesis that the racial tensions in America, while they are real, they are being emphasized in a negative and unhelpful way by actors who do not have the best interests of the entire society at heart, the Communist Party, who don't really care about the well-being of anyone in America. They just want to bring the government down. And that's kind of the perspective of the film. Arthur Kennedy plays that to the hilt, just using some pretty vicious rhetoric, sounding like, you know, the most hideous Twitter user.
Yeah, exactly. The reddest of the red Twitter users.
Post-left. That's kind of what he sounds like. He's a true believer. Yes. Kennedy does play it that way, right? Like, we don't believe he really feels these things, but he's willing to do or say anything tactically to achieve what he thinks. Now, he plays it as if he's a grifter, but he's the furthest thing from a grifter. He is an ideologue who has bought in that whatever the line coming from Moscow is, I'm going to do it in the firm belief that it will lead to the results that I want to see.
Glenn Ford has his moment, too, earlier, where he also tells Juano Hernandez that he is being used as a tool.
Yeah.
And Juano just doesn't, even if there may be some element of truth to that in both cases, Juano doesn't want to hear this. He doesn't appreciate being patronized in that way.
Well, I took it differently. I figure the way he plays it, he's processed all of that. He knows the situation in America. He knows that Black people are being horribly mistreated systematically. He happens to be a judge, but he knows this hasn't solved anything in general. But on the other hand, he is a human being. He deserves to be where he is. He's a very adept.
What can he do? Well, that's what I mean by patronizing, the idea that he wouldn't know
that
he was being used as a tool, but at the same time, what is he supposed to do about it?
That's right. I mean, and he shows everyone that they're wrong by presiding over the court. He takes the best middle course you could possibly imagine anyone taking in a situation like this, if you believe what the movie is telling you about the stakes involved and the influences that are being exerted upon the courtroom.
Now, this was a change from the novel. In the novel, Angel was hanged.
Oh,
and,
really?
Yeah, and the logic for changing it was simply that it was a bummer. And Mankiewicz was fine with that.
As long as we show the communists wanted him to hang, that's fine.
Yeah, he was fine with making money off of the movie, basically. Doing what he needed to do for that. Butts in seats.
At least we get to see, right? Because Glenn Ford, the ivory tower liberal, makes a clean breast of everything about how he is a fool.
Right.
In court, in public.
Well, it's also hilarious when he said, what I should have done is just... Because we've seen this a million times in movies, right? What I should have done is just... Oh, we had to...
Change the venue.
We saw it in Peyton Place, the TV show, that's what I'm thinking of. Change the venue, not to this town, right? Where everybody is very heated about this crime. I was laughing when he said that because, like, yeah, but then there would have been no movie. So that's why you didn't change the venue.
He was taken in. And that first scene is hilarious, too, where, well, it's not the first scene of the movie, but the first scene where we meet Glenn Ford, where his boss and the dean of the university are talking over, how can we keep this guy? Wonderful academic, but he's never practiced law in his life. Can we find some way to get him some experience before the next semester starts?
So in the novel, apparently this mentor is destroyed by the investigating committee.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. So yeah, they took a lot of that stuff out.
Yeah. So overall, the feeling I come away with from this movie is, yes, let's forgive and forget. Communism is not an essentialist state. It's not that once you are a communist, you are forever branded as evil and can never uncommunist yourself. You are not a witch.
No, that's right. Just wishing to destroy the American way of life. This movie does not do that. This movie portrays fellow travelers and Communist Party members who have a belief in a different kind of society and are going about it from the movie's perspective in a very wrong way.
Yeah, and who are intelligent, reasonable people.
And Dorothy McGuire is a great poster person for that. Now we turn to the 19th century and Friendly Persuasion. Leonard Maltin gives this one 4 stars out of a possible 4. Charming account from Jessamine West novel of Quaker family struggling to maintain its identity amid confusion and heartbreak of civil war. Warm, winning performances in this beautifully made film. Music by Dmitri Tiomkin. Though no screenplay credit appears, film was written by blacklisted Michael Wilson, remade for TV. Director William Wyler, and the cast list, Gary Cooper, Dorothy McGuire, Marjorie Maine, Anthony Perkins, Richard Eyer, Robert Middleton, Mark Richman, Walter Catlett, William Schallert.
So yes, a novel, but the novel consists of vignettes.
So they turned it into a more propulsive thing.
Absolutely. The account of the novel on its Wikipedia page sounds more like a collection of short stories.
I actually have it. I bought it a long time ago. I've never read it. It's somewhere around here.
Nothing. Like, I read the entire description of the vignettes. Nothing like the movie. Like, some of the episodes are drawn from it, and particularly the parent characters seem similar, but nobody gets involved in a Civil War fight in the novel. There's a comic episode where they think that some rebels are going to come by and they're going to have to fight them, but it doesn't actually happen.
Well, blacklisted screenwriter Michael Wilson.
Yeah, blacklisted screenwriter. And who else? I don't know. William Wyler decides to turn this in. Well, I guess, yes, William Wyler, having made movies such as, like, a lot of war movies, important war movies, such as The Best Years of Our Lives. I guess together, between them, they decided to turn this into a pacifist screed.
Quite an interesting film to come out in 1956. Can't think of too many movies about Quakers in general. Very interesting demographic group in America from very early on. Settlers of Pennsylvania. This family that we meet live in southern Indiana, so very close to the battle lines at certain points of the Civil War. That's definitely true. And Dorothy McGuire playing a preacher.
Jessamine West, the author of the novel, she based these stories on her mother's memories of growing up as a Quaker girl in southern Indiana, and particularly of her grandparents. So presumably a lot of these social aspects are correct. In terms of Dorothy McGuire being a minister, I was interested watching the movie and exactly how much authority that gave her, and apparently that comes up in the novel as well. Cooper's character is the head of the household, but she has this important role in the community, and usually he defers to her, but sometimes I guess she browbeats him a little too much. So there's a clash of authorities here that is resolved in a way that's comical in the movie.
Even at the church, well, it wouldn't be called a church, right? The meeting house. She's got people that she has to deal with. We've got the elders, the triumvirate of elders that come to visit them. But that would be the same in any situation. Certainly, Miracle Woman, we see at the beginning of that film, Barbara Stanwyck's dad has been deposed by the deacon and his clique.
Or what about Gone to Earth, where the citizens come to run the preacher out of town because he's living with a whore?
Right, so the preacher in any denomination, it's not like they are all powerful, but certainly she's got a much more powerful public role than most women would have in the 19th century, and even in a movie in the 1950s, it's kind of a different portrait of a family.
It's interesting, I don't think we've seen this exact side of Dorothy McGuire. I don't know if we'll ever see it again. In this role, she does have this sort of austerity.
I think the closest we've seen to this was in I Want You.
Serenity combined with austerity. Well, I wouldn't have associated this with her I Want You role. She's really angry in that movie.
She really lays down the law in that one, with Farley Granger, especially.
Well, what's interesting is that this matriarchy occurring in this household that comes in conflict with the patriarchy, it's not so different from a lot of classic American portrayals of the way authority got distributed in households. Everything from like Huck Finn to the modern sitcom, where the mother is the default rule setter, the person who lays down the morals in the household, and everyone else is like running around being bad behind her back. And the
dad is a man child.
Yeah, and the boys are man children, or children, boy children. The fact that she's a preacher just kind of reinforces that matriarchal backbone to the mythical American family.
So it does go both with and against the grain of what we're used to seeing.
Yeah, yeah. It sort of formalizes what we're used to seeing.
She has superior conviction for the most part. What Gary Cooper does is mostly based on whim, but they do eventually have their compromise on the organ, which is the big standoff until we get to the much more important standoff about fighting and killing.
Is it based on whim though? Is there not a real ideological difference here in that he would like what he considers, you know, harmless aesthetic pleasure to be brought into the house?
Yeah, but he didn't really think it through, right? He's just drunk and he gets talked into buying this organ by Walter
Callan.
Yeah,
but maybe that's because he has a deep set desire to have music in the house.
Anyone who gets sold something, there's a kernel there that gets inflamed by a good salesperson. And yes, it is there. He is not into this austerity, but normally he would just defer to what Dorothy McGuire thinks is best and thinks is right. It becomes more than a whim when she forbids him, and that's what he says. He's like, well, I can't allow you to forbid me to bring the organ in the house.
Well, yeah, exactly. And I mean that, like I'm saying, there's a clash of authorities between the patriarchy and the matriarchy and the spiritual authority and the household authority. But also it's just a very familiar situation. If you have two people living as partners, somebody's always got to compromise, or you have to compromise together, and they work out quite an elaborate compromise that also involves sexiness.
Sex in the barn.
How did you persuade her?
Friendly persuasion.
No kidding.
I really like Robert Middleton, I think, is the actor who plays Gary Cooper's best friend, who is not a Quaker.
Yeah, he's usually playing a villain.
Yeah, he was in Trial.
Oh, I didn't even notice.
He plays the sheriff.
Really? He played the sheriff?
Yeah, pretty amazing exhibition of Robert Middleton's skills. You didn't suspect for a minute it's the same guy. Yeah, here he's a very likable fellow. He's the person from the outside witnessing all of this, and he's not a Quaker. He doesn't buy into their belief system, but he respects it immensely, and he really hurts him to think that they're going to compromise on it, and that they're going to give in to the war hysteria, the way he's about to go give in.
So we have a series of episodes, seeds of the eventual confrontation, this crux of the questioning of pacifism, that's set up very early when they are confronted in the meeting house.
A representative of the Union Army marches in and asks them, what are you going to do about this great struggle to rid the country of slavery? And Dorothy McGuire is the spokesperson, as she should be, for that group, and explains that they are firmly anti-slavery, and they have been for quite a long time, which is true, consistent with Quaker philosophy on this from even in the 18th century, but certainly by the 19th century. Yes, this would have been across the board for Quakers in the United States, even in the South.
But you can't kill one man to free another, she says.
That's what she says, yeah.
Now, obviously this is something that the movie wants you to be soul-searching about from the start and throughout. How could anyone get anywhere believing that to the letter, right? But at the same time, you have to admire it as a principle.
Right, yeah, the movie really treads quite well on that very difficult line.
Now, were the Quakers millenarians?
Well, they were in the 17th century.
Because they're all willing to die for this belief, right?
You do know that they're called Quakers because they quaked. They were filled with the spirit and screamed and took their clothes off, etc., etc.
Hard to credit that, looking at these people.
The Society of Friends evolved, let's put it that way. It developed, and by the 19th century, a lot of Quaker bankers, and like they were not like the Amish, right? It's not like they're not part of the modern world. They don't want to separate themselves that way. They just want to be part of society while sticking to certain very core principles.
In any case, if they're going to improve the world they live in, and that's why I ask, are they millenarians? Do they even want to improve the world they live in?
Yeah, they do.
It's not going to be by means of violence. It's going to have to be by some other means.
That's right. That's right. And Quakers were very involved in anti-slavery from its beginnings in the UK, and certainly in the United States too, some very prominent anti-slavery speakers, abolitionists.
What would the means be, though? They were just going to convince the landowners in the South?
Yeah, moral suasion. I mean, Angelina and Sarah Grimke were slave owners from the South who converted to Quakerism and became very important speakers on this topic all across the United States. It worked on them. Why wouldn't it work on everyone? That was their belief, certainly.
Runaway slave who is
Enoch.
Yeah, who is their servant in this movie, not in the novel. So that, again, is highlighting their reasons for fighting in the movie.
Right.
Because the fighting does not take place in the novel.
He outlines the reasons why he has to fight, you know. He can't just stand by and let rebel raiders take over their town. I mean, they're going to lynch him for sure.
So this is, I guess, Wyler and Wilson, what, revisiting World War II again?
To some extent, it's hard not to see the parallels, right? I mean, it's another war where it's fairly easy to portray the side that, well, in this case, the Union Army, and in the 20th century, the American Army is fighting, is actually a nefarious force of evil, rather than just another group of people who want a certain territory. Of course, wars are always more complicated than that, but there is a cause here. It's very interesting, right? Because it's not like Anthony Perkins or Gary Cooper or any Quaker that we see. Well, except maybe the Quaker that we're shown, he's a bad Quaker. The guy that makes the speech at the beginning saying he will not fight, etc., etc., no matter what, he's going to hold to his principles. And then at the end, he's yelling at everyone for not fighting because they destroyed his barn. And he gets dressed down by Robert Middleton. And he's like, well, he's like the Comintern, right? He's basically saying, well, I've changed my opinion 180, and now everyone who disagrees with me is evil on the other side. So yeah, he's bad. He might actually go and fight for the Union Army, I don't know. But nobody else in this movie does, right? They take up arms to defend their community.
Right, so there, and also there's, since we're skipping ahead to the battle, I guess, it's a pretty unique portrayal of a battle in movies in that it's emphasizing the value of human life rather than, you know, just a whole bunch of bad guys or minions getting slaughtered.
Yeah, I mean, Anthony Perkins gives a very powerful performance in this movie. I think he's really good firing off these rifle shots and crying each time.
Oh, yeah, you know, yeah. So I was going to say, in order to accomplish that, the movie draws on some unique qualities of Gary Cooper and Anthony Perkins as actors, doesn't it?
It does.
So this is a tremendous performance from very young Anthony Perkins.
A coming star? Unfortunately, maybe appearing in Psycho did not do him any good.
He's the exact same person in Psycho. He's just a serial killer. Happens to have different off-screen stuff happening. Otherwise, he's basically the same performer, same persona, right?
Just has a different mother.
Although that scene with him and Dorothy McGuire, oh, son, if you do this, you... Well, she's tucking him in, her grown son, tucking him into bed. Son, if you do this, you turn against me. So it's not such a different mother-son relationship. Oh, no, mother, not against you. Yes, son, against me.
She does her best, but when he makes a decision that goes contrary to her wishes, she doesn't shun him. But yeah, a strong-willed mother, for sure, but a more benign one.
Norman Bates' actual problem with his mother was that she was having sex with somebody else.
So what were the special qualities of Gary Cooper that you feel feel were emphasized here.
Well, I mean, don't you agree that, particularly in the Capra movies, Cooper can have this otherworldly, benign presence about him?
Oh, I agree. Absolutely. He never does fight. He goes down to the battleground, ready to do what he needs to save his son. He finds his best friend just about dead, and then gets shot. He's able to overpower the rebel, take the gun from him, but that's all the fighting he does. And he explains to him that he's not going to kill him, and this man has some kind of a conversion experience and wanders off in a daze.
Yeah, it's a really incredible moment, isn't it?
It is. It's very well done.
Relief and incredulity on his face as he realizes he's not going to be killed, right?
Yeah, and Cooper does it all in his, you know, very low-key Cooper way. It's great.
Yeah, the whole role for Cooper is an amazing turn in his career, an amazing application of that persona, right?
Yeah.
And you know me, I can be hard on Gary Cooper.
It's true, you have been at times on the podcast. You know, Cooper is a guy who...
just not a fan of Mr. Deeds, that's all.
Yeah, I guess that's...
it's my pet peeve. Oh, and there's actually a reference after to a Cooper performance I do love. There's the reference to Morocco after, yeah, after he seduces Dorothy McGuire to get his way with the Oregon...
they and put a flower in his ear.
Middleton puts a flower behind his ear, yeah. He's still the lover boy.
Yeah, I mean, Gary Cooper had a pretty amazing career from the late 20s to his death. I mean, great performance after great performance. He never really lets up until his body gives out, unfortunately.
Yeah, and I mean, at this point, just such a rich history of uses of that persona to draw on for this role. But the brand new, unestablished Anthony Perkins does just as good a job. And Dorothy McGuire, who's kind of in between them there, she of course also has a great moment during this battle. So she is left behind with her daughter and the little boy when the troops arrive, when the rebels arrive, not least because of Gone with the Wind. What we are led to expect is that they're going to be raped.
Sure.
The girl, women are going to be raped, and...
or Mrs. Miniver. She has a confrontation with a Nazi in her house.
Yeah, so the women are going to be raped and the little boy is going to be killed or something. But, I mean, we know that's not going to happen in this movie, but at the same time, that's what you're led to fear, right? And of course, we know that armies of all political persuasions do get up to that sort of thing.
Unfortunately, it's a tale as old as human history, raping and pillaging by armed men.
But much like this soldier who is set free by Gary Cooper, they are so disarmed when Dorothy McGuire invites them to take what they need.
And that's what they are, right? They're a raiding party, so they're trying to get provisions.
And if there were any resistance, if there were any sassing, maybe they would just have a little extra violent fun. But yeah, like I said, she completely disarms them. They can't believe this is the case, and that calms them down just enough. But they are still, what's, of course, the fascinating tension is that these are still a group of frightening men who are aligned against her cause and harming people in her community who are taking her possessions and being real pigs about it. Obviously, this is traumatizing. The movie gives such a, because we always talk about this now, so much discourse about film and television is about trauma, and just discourse in general is about this big amorphous word that we've thrown everything into, this concept of trauma, right? And we think that maybe trauma didn't exist before, you know, David Lynch made Fire Walk With Me or something. But this movie is great for portraying trauma, the trauma that Anthony Perkins undergoes as he's forced to kill these men, and the trauma of Dorothy McGuire having her home raped by this group, right? And that eventually discharges itself.
Well, when she reaches her breaking point.
Yeah, when one of them tries to kill her pet.
Pet goose Samantha, the only goose that has a credit in a title sequence that I can think of. And an excellent performance by this goose, who's not even all that likable, right? Like,
nope.
Certainly not from the perspective of the youngest child, little Jess.
Who himself is thoroughly obnoxious. He's like an Ozu kid.
He is, yeah. He and Samantha are both Ozu kids.
Together.
And so they fight continually. But we're told from the beginning, Samantha is a pure pet, Dorothy McGuire's pet. specifically. She's the one that dotes on this goose.
And I feel when she breaks her principles there that it's interestingly balanced. It is comic, but it's not purely comic.
No, I mean, it does hurt her to do this. But on the other hand, yes, she must take up arms against this man and hit him until he lets the goose go. And he's about to kill the goose. There's no time for reasoning.
But it's not just about that. It's not just about no time. Like I said, all of this trauma that's been building, this violation she's been experiencing, it discharges itself. It has to discharge itself.
But I do think that it is primarily about this goose that she loves and is defending.
Yeah, for sure.
It would have had to discharge itself some other way if that scenario hadn't come up.
Or maybe she wouldn't have been brought to that point.
Possibly. And it does get treated comically later on as well, when Gary Cooper has been left in the dark about Dorothy McGuire's moment of apostasy.
Man, the little jerk old boy blurts it out.
And Samantha has had a change of heart and is now a very loving goose.
But he still hates her.
Well, he's petting her, though. So there has been some kind of a truce declared between them because of Samantha's new attitude. She's seen what humans with ill will might really do to her if she's not careful. I like almost everything about this movie. It's so well done. Beautiful cinematography. Some really nice performances, many by actors that, you know, I don't know very well. I think that the daughter is great too. Phyllis Love as Maddie. She was really good. I don't know her from anything else. Her love interest I thought was excellent as well. Robert Middleton's son. Gardner, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like she didn't really have a film career. No, yeah, she went right into TV and had been on the stage. She'd been part of the actor's studio.
Oh, cool. Large parts or small parts, it really all fits together. The It's a Wonderful Life bank examiner is one of the three elders.
Oh, right. That is a vignette right out of the novel.
Where the organ is playing way up in the attic and they're trying to make sure that these elders don't hear. Because, yeah, Gary Cooper has jeopardized his wife's standing with the Quaker community. She could lose her position if they find out that she's allowing music to be played or might even be complicit in music being played in her house. So she's not just being stubborn for stubbornness's sake there. And that's why they have to hide it up in the attic. It can't be on display.
The sexy persuasion is an invention of the movie.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. So in the novel, Eliza protests by sitting in the snow.
Oh, that's worse.
And then thinks better of that and comes back inside of her own accord, but he does have to put the organ in the attic.
I don't know. I think I like this better.
No, I love this fact that this Quaker couple in the movie have all this sexual chemistry.
Yeah, I think this was a good innovation. A great role for Dorothy McGuire all around. Again, I think it makes very good use of her particular qualities.
Which are?
Somehow a miraculous combination of harshness and grace that nobody else has that combination in the same proportions that she does.
I don't know, that makes me think of Margaret Sullivan, but Dorothy McGuire is usually a little bit sexier than Margaret Sullivan.
Yeah, and I think she has a little bit more of the grace in her than Margaret Sullivan. Margaret Sullivan can have grace, but
What about the Borzage movies? Come on.
Yeah, exactly. She can be when Borzage is using her, but most of the time she's emphasizing the harshness a little more. You know, it's always a question of the mood mix. You know, this soft-spoken but very rigid community head and partial head of household who's also got this very intense love for, well, her children and her husband.
And her goose.
Just really beautifully realized by the whole team here, and Dorothy McGuire is essential to the success of this film.
She really does seem a bit otherworldly.
Well.
And the technicolor definitely adds to that. The blueness of her eyes and that austere bone structure. And her face is just so composed through the whole movie. Composed and shining.
It is no accident that she is going to conclude her career, or I think her second to last film, she will be playing the Virgin Mary.
And yet you can still fully believe that she has this sexy relationship with Gary Cooper.
And with communists in other movies. All right. No fear in movie going in Toronto this week. Next week on the podcast, Elise, it's our special subject, the silent Vidor sampler. One of the great masters of the silent film. We're not going to be able to cover all of King Vidor's 1920s efforts here, but I've gathered a little selection for you, and I hope that you will watch them along with us and enjoy The Sky Pilot, Hego My Heart, Wild Oranges, and La Boheme.
I have seen none of these except La Boheme.
You're in for a real treat. See you soon.